zameen aur sama in ke sila jana kahan barti rahe ye roshni chalta rahe ye caravan to Pakistan jaan jaan Pakistan to Pakistan jaan jaan Pakistan to Pakistan jaan jaan Pakistan to Pakistan jaan jaan Pakistan.
Beautiful. Welcome to Cafe DC. I'm Faiz Rahman, and you just heard this beautiful, beautiful song, a version of a beautiful tune from Pakistan. And our guest today is Justin Shea. Justin, thank you very much for joining us. I know.
Thank you for having me, Faiz.
Absolutely. There are so many things that we want to talk about, but let's start with your music first. And I'll give our audience your little bit of your intro. You are the son of a very famous activist, American activist, who's been working diligently, you know, very, very working hard person in Pakistan, a hardworking person. He's been involved in lots of welfare and humanitarian causes in Pakistan. I'm talking about, ladies and gentlemen, Todd Shea. He was supposed to be here, but he couldn't be here because of his illness. And his son is here, who's been also working with him side by side. And like his dad, you're also a musician, right?
Yes, sir.
So let's talk about how did you get involved with this work, with your dad's work, and a little intro of the organization, please.
Well, I guess both his life and my life kind of took a turn on 9/11. He was scheduled to play a gig at a nightclub, a famous nightclub called CBGB's in New York on September 12th, so the next day. Unfortunately, you know, the attack happened, and he ended up, instead of playing his gig, because obviously that was canceled, he emptied his music van of his equipment and started bringing in different goods, food, water, eyewash, masks, anything that the cops and the firefighters going in rescuing people in the rubble might need. So he would pick up an order at CVS or Walgreens who were donating these goods, and he would ferry them in with his van. So he did that for about a week. And that's basically when I learned of what he was doing, because I had no idea during this time. We were calling back and forth to make sure we were okay, because we were worried at the time. But after that,
And where were you?
I was actually with my mother in Maryland.
Okay.
We turned on the TV and saw it happen. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. We obviously wanted to make sure my father was okay, because mm-hmm. we knew he was there. He had actually saw the second plane hit the towers. So after that, he kind of had his life changed and didn't really feel the same way about pursuing a music career as he used to. He felt it was, you know, maybe not as important as what else he could do, and that he really enjoyed and felt he was good at what he was doing at Ground Zero. So he went to some other disasters. He went to the tsunami in Sri Lanka, and he went to Haiti mm-hmm. After Hurricane Katrina. When the day he got back from that, he came to where I was staying, and we looked on the news, and there was an earthquake in Pakistan, mm-hmm. you know.
2005,
October. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure the exact number. It turned out that 80,000 people had died. At the time, I don't know what they were mm-hmm. saying at that time, but it was a huge disaster. We knew that. He called the Pakistan embassy, asked if anybody would need help. They gave them a number of some Pakistani-American heart surgeons called Operation Heartbeat that were going over. So he became their logistics coordinator, and went over there, basically managed their camp, getting them, you know, calling, setting up their logistics, getting whatever medicines and equipment they might need, making sure they had their food and water and their helicopter transports all taken care of, because obviously a doctor having to take their time out to do that is not going to spending more time treating patients. And at that time, medical help was very much in need. So he was there for quite a while, quite a few months. They had asked him to stay. He was originally only going to be there for a few weeks, a couple months, but they asked him to stay as the leader of the camp. And eventually, he discovered that he loved the Pakistani culture. He loved the children. He loved the work he was doing, so he started his own organization in Pakistan under their Societies Act called Comprehensive Disaster Response Services, and has since responded, his organization
CDRS.
Has responded to every, mm-hmm. CDRS, yes sir, mm-hmm. has responded to every disaster in Pakistan mm-hmm. since, and some others as well, Haiti, mm-hmm. Japan, and
Very
the Philippines.
Justin, you said that the attacks of 9/11
yes, sir.
Changed his life and yours as well.
Yes, sir.
And actually, to be fair with you and to your dad, a lot of people's lives changed in a big, huge way.
Absolutely.
But most of those changes were because they happened to be at that place at that time. For better or worse, you know, those who lost a lot of stuff because it was just a bad timing, bad place for them. And a lot of people, I mean, you know, they had to die because of the ensuing wars and, you know, other attacks around the world. But in your case and his, your dad case, it was not just the bad place or a bad timing or the time or the place itself, but actually his initiative.
Mm.
He felt the need to do something, right? And he took the initiative and he made calls.
Mm-hmm.
So as if he was not like, it was, I'm positive that he would have been perfectly all right in his own way, at some place, secure, safe, comfortable, had he not even taken this course of action.
Mm-hmm.
But he chose to take this course, right?
Absolutely.
Out of his heart, out of his personality, and again, went around the world and took upon these gargantuan tasks of mm-hmm. helping people in places where he had no clue how it was going to be treated and mm-hmm. You know, how people are going to perceive him. So I just wanted to put this on record that it was his initiative, his own doing, that he got involved
Absolutely.
In these, and appreciate your work as well, you know, on behalf
Thank
of
you.
Not just Pakistanis, but you know, Pakistani American people. So now, your role in the organization, what is it?
I am the outreach coordinator.
Okay.
So basically what that is I keep in contact with our donors and supporters mm-hmm. that we already have. I try to find new ones.
Mm-hmm.
I manage our social media.
Okay.
Last year, when I was in Pakistan, my last time I was there, mm-hmm. I was in Karachi.
Mm-hmm.
I also did a quick mission to Thar Parker. There was a famine going on.
Mm-hmm.
I brought food, water, and medicines there.
Mm-hmm.
But during my time in Karachi, I was staying with a family, and they helped me set up some talks at some of the local schools there.
Mm-hmm.
And we were starting our youth project, CDRS
mm-hmm.
Youth.
Mm-hmm.
And this is to a non-political, non-confrontational forum where we want students from all over Pakistan to come together to work for their country, doing whatever. We have had them previously on projects such as just cleanup of, you know, beautification of their local community. Recently, and I'm sure you've heard, Fez, that there was a heat wave in Karachi,
mm-hmm.
killed a few hundred people.
More than 1,300 people.
So yeah, mm-hmm. it was, the last time I checked, it was about 800.
In the province of Sindh altogether, yes.
So we mobilized our CDRS youth.
Mm-hmm.
Since I had started it last year, we had grown it mm-hmm. since I've been away as well.
And they're all volunteers, by
yes.
the way, from the local
We have
communities.
Two yeah. big chapters, one in Islamabad, one Karachi, some smaller here and there.
Mm-hmm.
So we mobilized about 50 volunteers that way.
Mm-hmm.
They distributed food, water, they set up medical camps. We worked with Shahid Abbasi Hospital,
mm-hmm.
Abbasi Shahid Hospital,
Abbasi Shahid Hospital
and Nizamabad.
Nizamabad. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And basically set up some iftar dinners for people,
mm-hmm.
had, you know, IVs and fluids available mm-hmm. for when people, you know, are feeling faint
mm-hmm.
or, you know, so. We donated about $5,000 in medicines,
mm-hmm.
and we ended up spending another $5,000 in food, water for the people.
Mm-hmm. How often do you go to Pakistan?
I have only been twice, unfortunately.
Okay.
The first time I went was
mm-hmm.
in 2008,
mm-hmm.
3 years after my dad had been working there, to a place called Chikar near the line of control with India,
mm-hmm.
In Kashmir,
mm-hmm.
Azad Kashmir. And I guess all I can say is it's an eye-opening experience.
Mm-hmm.
I had never been, except to Canada, I had never been outside of the United States
mm-hmm.
before that summer. And it was amazing. I loved it. I loved
mm-hmm.
the people. They were very, very friendly to me. Not at all what you might expect
mm-hmm.
hearing some of the things that is said about Pakistan and in other areas in the media, in the US media. But another fun fact, we had drove down to Islamabad, flown to Karachi to stay with the family there. I turned 18 in Karachi that first trip. So I guess you could say I became a man.
Yeah.
Yes, you could say I became a man in Pakistan. The last time, and I explained, I was I had gone to with my father last year in March, mm-hmm. So we were setting up the CRS Youth. We did this mission to Thar Parker. Mm-hmm. I honestly would love to go a lot more, mm-hmm. but you know. While he's over there working on things, I try to stay here and manage what I can while he's away. So.
Okay, now going back to your music.
Yes, sir.
How did you learn these Pakistani songs?
Well, my father was a musician, obviously, before he started this relief work. And he had, ever since I was 4 years old, I was getting up on stage singing with him. I would hear his songs over and over again. One night I just decided to come next to him and just start singing because I felt like it. And eventually he saw that I was getting better. He let me sing some of the songs with him. You may not know, but some of these songs were Cats in the Cradle. It's actually a song about a father and son's relationship developing mm-hmm. as the son becomes a man. Mm-hmm. So it was, you know, that's a really fond memory I have. But even as a musician and now as a humanitarian, he's always traveled around a lot. I would either be traveling with him or during the school time, I would be with my mother doing my school studies. So I took the time and I just tried to learn the guitar as much as I could. Eventually got good enough to start playing
Beautiful.
Some English songs.
Yeah.
And when my dad started working in Pakistan, he started introducing me to these artists such as Atif Aslam and...
Do you know some Atif?
I do.
Stuff?
Actually, the first song...
Before we take the break, would you like to play something for us?
Sure, sir. This is the first song, Urdu song I ever learned.
Okay.
And I basically just learned it by listening to the record over and over.
Okay.
कब से उम्मीदें कुछ बाकी हैं मुझे पे भी तेरिया क्यों आती हैं ना जाने कब से अब तो आदत सी है मुझको इसे जीने में जिंदगी से कोई शिकवा ही नहीं है अब तो जिंदा हूँ मैं इस नीले आसमान Thank you. अब तो आदत सी है मुझको इसे जीने
Great, great, Justin. Obviously, music is a great connector.
Yes, sir.
I mean, when you play these kinds of songs in Pakistan, you connect with the people right away. And I'm sure you must have received a great, great response from, especially
Absolutely.
From the youth in Pakistan. I promise that we'll take a break after, you know, you play this song. When we come back, we want to know more about your involvement with Pakistan, especially with the Pakistani youth. So please yes, stay sir. With us. More interesting stuff is coming up.
Since 2005, the last basically 10 years of us being in operation, we've treated nearly a million patients. So we're quite proud of that.
Welcome back. I'm Faiz Rahman and you're watching Cafe DC. Our guest today is Justin Shea, who's been working in Pakistan along with his dad, Todd Shea, with the humanitarian causes in Pakistan. Once again, welcome back, Justin. When we left, we promised that we'll talk about your work in Pakistan. So what are the current projects that you've been working with?
Well, we just wrapped up this heat wave response in Karachi, but we had also for 10 months been working with Imran Khan Foundation mm-hmm. in Banu to help the people who flee from the attack in North Waziristan, the Pakistan Army and the Taliban mm-hmm. conflict.
The IDPs, they call
IDPs,
it.
The IDPs, yes,
yep.
sir. And so we were supposed to only be there for a month or two, and then they extended it to 3 months. It turned out they ended up wanting us to stay for 10 months. They did not have a medical healthcare wing for Imran Khan Foundation. Mm-hmm. So my father and Imran Khan know each other. And in a non-political way, he does a lot of humanitarian projects mm-hmm. that we're willing to help with. Mm-hmm. We're willing to help anybody if they can support.
Absolutely,
if they can
yeah.
Work. And so. We treated about 115,000 patients there.
115,000?
Yes, sir.
Wow.
Yes, sir. With, that was probably the biggest budget we'd received. We received a budget of $500,000 mm-hmm. for that. And when we have the money, we can do
Absolutely,
very
yeah.
big things with it. We also, before that, had worked in the Punjab floods and treated 52,000 patients in that conflict. Total. In our since 2005, the last basically 10 years of us being in operation, we've treated nearly a million patients total. So we're quite proud of that, and we hope to keep.
And some
doing
of
a
those
lot
numbers,
more.
Just for the audience, so that they know, these are very verifiable numbers. You know, you can back up these mm-hmm. numbers through your, their records and everything, right? These are like,
Yes, sir. Okay. They can see all of our financial audits. We get a double audit, mm-hmm. both in Pakistan and in the U.S. Mm-hmm. Every year, you can see them. They're all posted on our website, cdrspakistan.org. Mm-hmm. They can ask
cdrspakistan.org.
Yes.
Okay.
They can contact me or my father on our Facebooks, Todd Shea or Justin Shea. Mm-hmm. His email, Todd Shea at cdrspakistan.org. Mine, TJ Shea, Shea, TJ Shea at cdrspakistan.org.
Okay. So, some of your challenges. I know Pakistan, lovely people, lovely country, beautiful places. But there are, as we know, there are quite a few challenges. Pakistan's been a victim of terrorism for a long time.
Absolutely.
And especially for Americans, it's been pretty tough. The United States State Department, they have this, you know, warning on their website. Those Americans who are traveling to Pakistan, they actually advise them not to. So how do you handle those security threats, and how do you feel? Is that a big challenge to deal with?
Well, in the last 10 years, neither my father or anybody in the organization has spent a rupee or a cent on security. We don't believe in armed guards.
Amazing.
We don't believe in big vehicles intimidating the people we try to serve. When we need to go into a new area that may have some tension, we go in quietly, we go in small vehicles. My father and I may sometimes dress up in Sharkamese, depending. But one time he went in a Pink Floyd t-shirt to SWAT, and he just talked. He asked the people, he said, "I'm here, I'm not here to do anything but help you. Please, I want to come here and ask you what you need." And so one of the problems at that time was that someone had brought in a truckload of fans, but there was no electricity for the camp. So the fans were just an eyesore. Mm-hmm. My wife and my children are hot, you know, being exposed to this heat, and I got to look at the fans that aren't doing anything. So one of the things we did in that was, knowing that that was a problem, we got electricity to that camp.
And how?
I'm sorry?
How did you get that electricity? The generators or?
Yeah, generators. Okay. We brought in generators. Okay. And you know, basically other people to set that up. Mm-hmm. What my father and I do is more logistics, setting people up with other experts of, mm-hmm. or other services, other products that they need to be brought in.
Serve as connectors,
yes.
Connect people,
exactly.
And organizations
Which
together.
Which is a lot more difficult than, mm-hmm. you would think, mm-hmm. Coming, especially working in an area like Pakistan that doesn't, unfortunately, doesn't have the infrastructure, mm-hmm. and the government doesn't have the ability to service all of these areas. So by the end of that trip, the fathers were letting my father pose with their sons and daughters, holding them, their children in photos. They were embracing him like a brother. So, you know, if you go in, if you're honest with yourself and to the people you're serving, they will see this, and it may take some time, but, you know, build their trust. And they even say now that it is on their family honor that they protect us when we are there. So this
What's
is what
the
we
next
believe
big
in.
Dog, sorry. What's the next big goal for your organization,
yes,
yours
so
and your father's big goal in Pakistan?
We're working on a few things. Our most notable thing that we're currently doing right now is we're ramping up a women's empowerment project. We are basically trying to provide a financial means for some of these women in these areas, especially SWAT, who can't really work anywhere outside of their homes. So we have brought them equipment that they can use, sewing machines and other embroidery that they can work on themselves. And we have begun actually selling that at our, not really selling, giving it as a gift in exchange for a donation. So if somebody will, if somebody gives $75 or more, they get that scarf in return. Some of them are $150. Basically that has done very well in just our first summer. We sold all of the scarves that we had brought. So we're hoping to get more, but basically they get a big percentage for themselves as salary, mm-hmm. for their work. The rest goes into,
great.
Either the Women's Empowerment Project to build it or to our hospitals there, mm-hmm. so that we can keep giving health care to them.
Great.
So
great.
None of it, mm-hmm. is for profit. It is all it's a for-profit generating for non-profit humanitarian work.
Wish you all the best. And again, thank you very much for, you know, hard work and your sincere work in Pakistan and places like that around the world, not just in Pakistan.
It's our pleasure.
Justin, I think it will be perfect for you to play an English or an American song while we, you know, try to end this
sure.
program.
Absolutely.
And I'm sure our audience will enjoy it. So thank you very much for watching this Cafe DC with Justin Shea. Again, as I said, you will just listen to and see his song, an American song. Over to you, Justin.
lock of hair in a pocket. Wears a cross around her neck. Yeah, the hair is from a little boy. And the cross is from someone she has not met. No, not yet. She says she talks to angels. Say they call her out by her name. Oh, yeah, she talks to angels. And they call her out by her name. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pat.
Appreciate it being here. Thank you.